Good evening.
Yes.
Baruch Hashem, I came back yesterday from Belgium, from Europe. We had a great Shabbaton there. One nice thing about Belgium, the Jews in Belgium, they all speak fluent Hebrew. They speak such good Hebrew that you don't, as Israeli, you don't recognize that they're not Israelis. You know, it's hard. If an American guy is, here someone speaks English, he knows right away it's from America or not, right? You see, I cannot tell the difference between people from Toronto to people to New York. For me, it sounds the same. But Americans can tell that they're not from, you know. Even Brooklyn accent, people can tell. They have influenced by Italian. It's interesting, but good news is that today I got a call from there that many of the people there woke up. One nice thing about Belgium, you hardly have intermarriage over there. Two places in the world are very unique, meaning all the other places that I've been are doing extremely bad, except two places. One is Panama, and second is Belgium. There's two unique things about these communities. One, there's almost no intermarriage. In Panama, it's 2%. In Belgium, something like that. And also, no drugs. The youth are not into drugs. Everywhere else you go, almost everyone uses drugs. Almost everyone. Sleeping pill, smoking grass, cocaine, heroin. Who knows how many different kinds of drugs. Over there, you don't have this epidemic. It's very interesting. You have to always, if you search what's the root of it, I'm sure we're going to find what's the reason. But one thing we do see here, that it's possible. I started to think that that's it, the world is so corrupted and so bad, that really there's no way to save these two epidemics. One is intermarriage, and second is drugs. That the Jewish nation is a lost case, that's it. It's just a matter of another 10, 20 years until we will be gone with these two problems. But apparently, there's some light in different parts of the world, which is different. You know, I heard today a story. There was a professor, his name Yehuda Bauer, Israeli professor, anti-religion, like most of them. So he heard that the survivors from Auschwitz, they told a story that in camps, after they killed some of their children and their relatives and parents and the tragedy, you know, that they had, Hanukkah came. We are before Hanukkah now. Hanukkah is coming soon. And they wanted to light the menorah. But, you know, they don't have oil. So what happened is, they gave them every day one slice of bread with a little margarine. That was the food. So they used the margarine instead of eating it on the bread for the oil. They collected all the margarine and they lit the menorah. They made the menorah by taking potato and making holes in it. You know, things like this. But how would they light? So every one of them took the buttons out and with the string, they put it in the candle somehow, and they lit as much as they could. So he said, I don't believe that Jews, that their children just got murdered, they had the head to lit a menorah to God. It cannot be. I don't believe. I don't buy this nonsense. Somebody made up that story. And they decided to make an investigation, proving that it's one of these myths. People made it up. And after he made a serious investigation and interviewed a lot of different people, he found out that not only that the story is true, he said the biggest shock I got is that the people that had that they did that, were all people who were married to goyim, to non-Jewish women, meaning that their children are not even Jewish. Their children are not Jewish. If you marry a non-Jewish woman, your children are not Jewish. You're done. You cut your genealogy all the way to Moshe Rabbeinu. I don't have to tell you about the consequences when the person dies and he stands in front of God, the punishment he's going to get. eternal punishment. But before even talking about punishment, you don't want your own children, you don't want to establish a family, you don't want your children to go after you. So he said that those were the Jews that they put them in camps, even though they're marrying non-Jewish women, their children, according to the Torah, were not even Jewish. They did nothing Jewish in their life. They were totally secular. And after all of that, when they were in the biggest tragedy of their life, like, you know, parents died, brothers died. I don't have to tell you that in a case like that, a person to be able to continue to follow God is not so simple. It's very difficult. Because a person reacts with emotions, and emotions is always the opposite of the truth, especially when it's painful. People react with emotions is usually not the truth. If you use your brain, you can follow the truth. If you use your heart, you usually it's always going to lead you to the wrong direction. So he said that was his biggest shock. He cannot explain how people like that, that were so far, they gave their last piece of margarine and their buttons. Even a button had a value in the camps. A button, believe it or not, people could make an exchange. You know, a little cigarette that they picked up on the floor. Everything had a real value over there. This is people that were very rich. You know, the Jews in Germany, they were very rich. They were very successful. They were judges, lawyers, just like in America, same style. Artists, all kinds of successful antique collectors. And being on the top of the world, running big corporations and banks and who knows what else, all of a sudden to be put in a cage that a button that you wouldn't even care about all of a sudden became the most important position you have in your life. I don't have to tell you about the tragedy here. From the top all the way to the bottom. Someone said today a sad joke. A sad joke. Some of the jokes are more sad than funny when you understand where they come from. He asked, do you know what's the difference between the American Donald Trump to the American liberal Jews? What's the difference? One main difference that you can name.
Trump's grandkids are Jewish.
You heard that, right? That the grandchildren of Donald Trump are Jewish. Meaning their grandchildren, none of them will be Jewish already. That's it, that's reality. When I say it, instead of crying for the situation, they find me as a victim. What is he saying? What is he saying? I say, I don't say, does it make the reality any difference? It's reality. With more than 70% intermarriage, give it another two generations, when they have their grandchildren, what are the odds they'll be Jewish b'chlal? Almost zero. All these things happen. It's not the first time. It happened 150 years before the Holocaust started. It started in Europe by Moshe Mendelssohn, an Orthodox rabbi that his children went to college. That's it. They were very religious, all the family. They decided to go to college in Germany. Within the time they went to college, they met non-Jewish girls, Germans. They married them. Later, they were forced to convert to Christianity because that was the condition. You want to marry me, you have to be a German Christian, you know? And they all were disappeared. That's it. Nobody knows where this Mendelssohn family, they're all gone. But then, that was the beginning of the Haskalah movement 220 years ago. About 150 years before the Holocaust, intermarriage started officially everywhere. And then by the time he got to the Holocaust, there was no way even to know who's a Jew, who's not a Jew. I mean, today, when you look at the Jewish last names, the majority of them are not Jewish. Don't be impressed when you hear Hoffman and Feldman and Cohen and Levy and Rosenberg. Most of them are not Jewish. So make no mistake. By last names, you cannot tell who is a Jew and who is not a Jew. Also, by when you hear Christopher or names of Goyim, that doesn't mean they're Goyim, they could be Jewish. Last name is not an indication of anything anymore. Maybe 100 years ago, most of the Jewish last name were Jewish. Here and there, you had none. But today, by far, the majority of the Jewish names in America are not Jewish. In Israel, the majority of the Jewish names are still Jewish. But if it will continue the way it goes, another few generations, it will be like here. But as of now, when you hear someone in Israel that tells you that his name is Cohen or Levi, most likely he's Jewish. But also no guarantee. Most likely. This is how sad it gets. The Jewish nation got the title, they were chosen, they got the Torah. Their job was to represent God in the world, to teach the truth of God. Their mission was to be isolated, to stay together, not to intermarry the nations. And almost all of them betrayed God. All of them, almost all the Jewish people betrayed him. The sad part is that as a nation, almost nothing is left. Only 13 million Jews left in the world. We should have been 4 billion, statistically. Because if Chinese, you have close to 2 billion, and they had restriction on birth all these years, Jews never had restriction on birth. They can have 15 kids a family. So there's a big difference if you have 6, 7, or 10 kids, or one kid per family, for a period of 200-300 years, is a huge difference. We should have been, we started in the same generation like the Chinese people, 4,200 years ago, after the flood, when all the people in the world were cleaned, they all died, all the wicked people, and a family of 8 left, Noah and his family. And Noah had 3 sons. One of them is the Semite race, which is the Jews. Also the Arabs came from Shem. And the rest is the Gentiles, the Europeans, the Americans, all came from Jeff, Yefet, and all the Africans, and the Chinese, and some of them came from Ham, people from the East and from Africa. As you can see, it's described in Parashat Noach, the genealogy. And from the Jewish nation, like I said, instead of being 4 billion people, only 13.2 million people left. And the reason for it is mainly, besides Holocaust and pogroms and all of that, mainly intermarriage. Mainly. If intermarriage did not exist, the Jewish people would be the biggest and the strongest nation in the world, in history. Imagine in Russia, there's a few hundred million Russians. I don't know exactly how many, but probably less than a billion. All together in Russia. It's the strongest country in the world. With the United States, there's 400 million people in the United States. Many of them are immigrants, but the United States is a very strong country. Only 400 million people here. That's it. 400 million people, and they control a large portion of the world. The Russian as well. Imagine 4 billion Jews in the world with the brain the Jews had and so much they contributed to science and to the world and develop almost everything you see today. All comes from Jewish brains. With 13 million people in the world only, deduct the old people, deduct the children, how many potential brains you have? Maybe 4 million, maybe. That's it. 4 million brains that potentially can contribute to the world in medicine, in science, in technology. 4 million! After you take off the little children and the older people, you know, 80, 90, 100, take off all the little children up to 18, how many adults you have in a Jewish nation altogether, all over the world? Maybe 4 or 5 million. And they basically contribute to the world more than 7.5 billion goyim. Check the Nobel Prize winners. Check in science. Check how many doctors in the United States and lawyers. Check what's going on. You're not going to believe it. Hard to believe. It's mamash hard to believe. If the Jews would only know their own history, they'll be not only amazed, they'll be more than amazed. But the Torah already say it. The Torah say, I'm going to spread you in all the nations, and everywhere you're going to be, you will always be the highlight of the place. Ve'aita sham lemashal ulishnina. Shnina comes from the word shanun. Shanun in Hebrew means chad, sharp. You will always be the sharpest people and the most successful people on earth. Not only that, every country you're going to be in exile, when I'm throwing you there, for instance, Egypt, or Babylon, which is Iraq, or Europe, or United States, or Russia, or Iran, all these places where the Jews live in large, there was a large communities of the Jews in Persia, in the time of the Shah, and then in Germany and in Russia, and today in the United States, most of the Jews live here in the United States, about 6 million. So wherever the Jews live, this country automatically is blessed. But as soon as they kill them or they leave, the country collapses and nothing survives over there. Few examples. When the Jews were in Egypt, I don't have to tell you, read the story of Pharaoh that controlled the whole world, thanks to Yosef. Everybody came, all the money went to Pharaoh, Egypt was in control in the whole world. Then the Jews left, ran away, Egypt collapsed, nothing survived from them. They don't exist anymore. No memory from the ancient Egyptians. The Egyptians today are all Muslims, all Ishmaelim. Nothing to do with Pharaoh and his nation. They were not Ishmaelim, they were different Egyptians. None of them survived. There's not one of them left in the world that can say, I'm a grandson of Pharaoh. Nothing. Nothing left from them. Then the Jews went to Babylon. Babylonians. Nothing is left from Babylon. Today you have Arab Iraqis over there. There's no Babylonians. Nebuchadnezzar and his nation are gone. There's no memory of them anywhere in the world. The Jews went to Spain. Spain was the biggest empire. Cultural, science, doctor, medicine. Spain, 500 years ago. They started to kill and to throw the Jews away and torture them. The Christian Inquisition in Portugal also was a big, massive place. They kicked them out. The Jews left their homes. Nothing, everything was stolen from them. Where is Spain today? Almost nothing survived from them. Tiny country, bankrupt. They have nothing left. Portugal, same story. Greeks, the biggest empire in the world. They controlled the Jews. They came, they made them problems. Once the Jews got rid of them, what's left from Greece? A tiny nation, also bankrupt. Nothing is left from them. Where is the empire of Greece that controlled the entire world? They were much bigger than the United States today. But nothing is left from them. Germany, in the time of Hitler, as the strongest country in the world, everyone was shaking from them. Biggest army, in control, wealth, everything. After the Holocaust, they became a small European country. That's it. Russia, before, when they let the Jews go, when the Jews live in Russia, many, many hundreds of thousands of Jews live there. By the day they opened the border and let them leave, they didn't let them leave. The Jews couldn't leave Russia. You couldn't leave communist Russia. Well, one day they changed the way they are, and they let them go. As soon as the Jews, all of them, started to go out to America and to Israel, Russia collapsed. USSR was 12 countries, I believe. They collapsed. They became many different countries. And the economy there were extremely horrible. Even now, it's horrible, the economy. They're doing very bad. So you can see that it's a pattern. You treat the Jews nice. You give them freedom. You don't kill them. You don't put them in camps. You don't throw them to exile. Your country automatically is in power and blessing. You start making them problems, I destroy you. This is what God say. Why? The whole world is for my children. The only reason you have an existence as a Gentile is thanks to the Jewish nation. Without them, I wouldn't need you. It's the same thing that Adam said, that Hashem said in the Torah, Adam cannot be alone. He needs a woman. Let me create a woman for him. So he created Eve from Adam's DNA, and he made it clear in the Torah that without Adam, Chava doesn't have an existence. Women came to the world for the men. They don't like it. They want to be feminists. They have all these things that they invented today. But the only reason they have an existence is because God decided that a man needs a woman. And it's not good for him to be alone. It's written in a divine book. You like it, you're lucky. You don't like it, you have a problem. You think you can change reality? This is what God says. It doesn't mean that the women does not have an importance and they don't have a purpose. Of course they do. They go to heaven, they can be righteous. The nation is getting saved thanks to them. The future of the children is in their hands. There's a lot of responsibility. Also the Gentiles. The Gentiles has a purpose. They can go to heaven, they can be righteous Gentiles. Some of them were prophets in history. Some of them, the Tanakh is giving an example of how to be, like Yov. It was a very serious, righteous guy. And there were many other goyim that were righteous in history. Actually, it's funny, many of the Jews, they live in illusion that that's because they're Jewish, they're going to go to heaven. Because they heard somebody told them, "Kol Yisrael yesh lahem chelek la'olam haba." Every Jew has a share to the world to come. But it's not true, because the Mishnah continue, and those are the Jews who have no share to the world to come. And it's written in the Gemara at least 100 times, that I remember, at least 100, that those are the Jews who lost their share to the world to come. Someone who does this and this and that. He has no share to the world to come. Ain lo chelek la'olam haba. Amalbin pnei chavero barabim. Ain lo chelek la'olam haba. Keilu shofech damim. It's like a murder. Mechalel Shabbat. His soul gets cut out of olam haba. Idol worshiper. He loses olam haba. Eating on Yom Kippur. His soul gets cut. Eating chametz on Pesach. Here you go. I can give you 36 examples that the Torah say that this Jew's soul is getting cut out of the eternal life. If a Jew is married a non-Jewish woman, or even having a relationship with her, according to the Zohar, to Kabbalah, is the biggest sin in whole Judaism. The relationship with a non-Jewish woman, this is the story in the Torah that Yosef, that he went to Egypt when he was 17 years old, and they put him in the house of Potiphar, and he was a servant. He was a Hebrew servant, and he was, working in the house of one of the ministers of Egypt, and his wife was an extremely beautiful woman, was getting dressed for him and putting all kinds of shows. And the Torah said that Yosef did everything he can to avoid contact with her, because he knew, it's written in the Torah, that if he will be with her once, she will be tied to him in the next world forever. And that's the biggest shame that a person can imagine. The biggest shame. I'll give you an example. Let's think for a second of a very respectful businessman. He dressed the best suit, nice car, nice briefcase, expensive watch. And now he's making a meeting with the head of a big bank. He has a meeting, we're talking hundreds of millions of dollars deal. So he comes to the place, and as he's about to enter their office, a little lousy dog from the street, homeless dog, maybe has rabies also, he walks next to him and he's attached to his leg. And he wants to come in, and I say to him, "Sir, what, is this your dog?" He said, "No, I don't know what he wants from me. Everywhere I go, he follows me. Get out of here. Call security." The dog doesn't leave him alone. He wants to come to a cab, he jumps in. He wants to come to his building, he jumps in. I'm just giving an analogy. He won't be able to get rid of it. Lavdil, for a change, we're talking here now that in the next world, it's a different spiritual aspect that we know from here. Over here, when a Jew has a non-Jewish girlfriend, not only is not embarrassed of it, he's sometimes even bragging. Very pretty, he's excited. "Wow, someone like me finally got such a pretty girl. Where will I get a Jewish girl like this that will agree to go with me?" That's how he thinks. But he doesn't know that when the time comes, he will curse every second he was with her. Not because she's bad. Don't make no mistake. Not because he's better than her. Could be she's more righteous than him. Some of these goyot, they love God more than some of these Jews, bichlal. Not because he's better than her, because this is the rules of God. We didn't write it. This is what God said to the Jewish nation. Whether you want, whether you don't want, whether you agree with me, you don't agree with me, who cares? These are the rules. You don't have permission to mix with any other nation. The good nations, the bad nations, the greatest nations. You don't have permission. Even when the Jews were slaves, in the time of the Greeks or the Romans sold the Jews 2,000 years ago to Egypt like dogs. The Jews reached the lowest level ever. They were selling a Jew as a slave for a price of a horse meal, meaning $5. You know those straws that the horses, the boxes of straws that the Jews are eating? So a Jew 2,000 years ago, after the destruction of the Second Temple, when the Jews were on the top of the world with the Temple in Jerusalem and all that, when the Romans came and destroyed Israel and Jerusalem and the Temple, they took the Jews mamash like animals and they sold them to Egypt, and no one wanted to even buy them. They had to beg them to buy them for $5. So even then, if a princess of Rome, the daughter of the queen of Rome, would come to one of the slave Jews that has handcuffs, and they take him like a donkey. Come, you're going to clean the bathroom of these Egyptians here in Egypt. And she would tell him, marry me. She's a princess, much better than him. Look at this situation, look at her. He still didn't have permission to marry her. Doesn't matter, even though she's now on the top of the pyramid. She will get him out of his misery. He doesn't have permission. It's not because we are the best and they are over here. They're not in our level. That's not the reason. Because even someone like Iov, which was a very big prophet, a non-Jewish prophet, righteous prophet, could not marry the worst wicked Jew, a prostitute Jew. She couldn't marry him. He's a righteous person. God is talking to him. He's a prophet. He's going to a high level in the heaven of the Gentiles. She's a prostitute, the biggest lowlife. She cannot reach 1% of his level. He's doing her a favor if he agreed to take her. She's still not allowed to marry him. You understand? For all these people who think it has something to do with racism or levels, totally wrong. It's nothing to do with your level. It's nothing to do with racism. This was God's plan to reserve his children as a nation. He knew once you open the borders and everyone can marry everyone, in 5-6 generations, there will not be one Jew left. That's it. You won't find any because they're all mixed. And once you get mixed, your children are not Jewish. This is the law. Why did I even give the Torah for? Why did I even make the whole plan if after 5 generations nothing will be left? Without the ultra, ultra religious people, you would not have a Jewish nation left today. Think about it. The only people that can know for sure that their children are Jewish are the ultra orthodox people today in the world. The Reform, almost all of them are goyim. Conservative, the vast majority of them are goyim. Secular Jews, the vast majority of them are goyim today. The only one that are for sure Jewish, and also the word for sure is with a question mark, because we don't know what happened 50 years ago, 100 or 200 years ago. We don't know. Today, they're ultra-Orthodox for the last 5-6 generations, as we can tell. But we don't know, maybe 10 generations ago, the grandmother was not Jewish. She somehow sneaked into the nation. One Jew married her. She was very religious, but she wasn't Jewish. I can show you 100 girls that live 100% like Orthodox Jews today, and they're not Jewish. They keep everything. They light Shabbos candle, they keep Shabbat, they dress modest, they give donation, 100%. Attached to Hashem, and they're not Jewish. 100%. I see everywhere I go, it's the same like that. And I tell them, you need to convert. You cannot live all your life with a 1% chance that your grandmother, you think that she was Jewish. It doesn't work that way. You know, I got an invitation to go to Nigeria. I thought in the beginning, what, Nigeria? To the Jewish community of Nigeria. I said, Jewish community in Nigeria? I didn't think there's one Jew in Nigeria. So the woman that gives lectures, she's a Kiruv organization in Israel. She sent me 5 or 6 videos of the Jewish community in Nigeria. All black Nigerian people, all with yarmulke and tzitzit. And you have to see how they pray in Hebrew. You have to see when they have... I always like to learn from what I see, not just to see. To look at from all aspects why Hashem is showing it to me. So I see about 50 black men, of course men separately, women separately, kosher 100% like the halacha, and they were singing Az Yashir Moshe, okay? The song of the Moshe Rabbeinu, Az Yashir Moshe of Bnei Israel. When we pray in the morning, it takes maximum 2 minutes. Maybe 20 minutes video finish my whole memory on the phone. How long they sing, like this, then sing. You had to see the love they have for the prayer. And the guy praying Hebrew, Tfilat Shmona Israel, did not make one mistake. Black guy. Here, 9 out of 10 people who come to pray don't know how to pray. They make so many mistakes in the Hebrew. They mix between words, the grammar is incorrect. Mamash, a lot of people don't know. Israelis I'm talking. Needless to say, Americans. Israelis that grew up in Israel, Hebrew is their everyday language. They don't know how to speak. They make mistakes, almost everybody. And over there you had to see how they pray. Not one mistake this guy made. In Jamaican, in a Nigerian heavy accent. But still, he pronounced the word correctly. How there are Jews in Nigeria? I have to investigate. I don't know. Is it really true that it's going for 2,000 years that Jews went to Nigeria and they kept their community? They show a picture of the cemetery with Star David on the graves. I don't know. I have to check. But here you go. This is the way it is. That's the way the Jews were traveled, and they're scattered all over the world. And today, there is something left. Something left from 13.2 million, 2.5 million are connected to Hashem. That's it. Our job is to try to save few more millions. Few more. If we'll be able to do it, if the majority of the Jewish nation will be Shomer Shabbat, there's a very high chance that Mashiach would come. Because there is a concept in Judaism, it's called Rubo Kechulo. A majority, it's like all of it. Because in the Torah, when you have a mixture, if the majority is kosher and the minority is not kosher, it's kind of like the whole thing is kosher. Why? But it's 40% not kosher. But once you have a majority that it's kosher, it actually makes the whole thing kosher. The rabbis, Chazal, they made a decree that it cannot be more than 1.6%. The minority, if it's not kosher, has to be batel b'shishim, 1 to a 60. You know? Otherwise, it's not kosher, but it's from rabbinical. It's from the Torah, the majority, 51% is kosher, the whole thing is kosher. So if 51% of the Jewish people will be Shomer Shabbat, for the first time after who knows how many years, there will be a majority of people who listen to Hashem and live by the rules. As of now, like I told you, maybe 25%, 20, 25% are connected. All we have to do is to double the amount. We make another 2.5 million Balei Tshuva. That will change the entire future and fortune of the Jewish nation. This coming Shabbat, it's going to be Parashat Chaye Sara. You know, we read that we have, I told you last week, we have three chapters in the Torah that's speaking about the life of Avraham Avinu. First one was Lech Lecha, go out of the land here, when he was 75 years old. And then we went into Vayera, the story that he went to release his nephew Lot, and the guest that came to his house and told him that he's going to have a baby. And now, you know, and also the birth of Yitzchak and the Akedah, that he took Yitzchak to slaughter him when he was 37 years old. And now we're going into the life of Chaye Sara. The life of Sarah, that's the name of the parasha. This is the fifth chapter of Genesis, of Sefer Bereshit. It's very interesting that the name of the parasha is the life of Sarah, when actually it should have been the death of Sarah. Because we already read about Sarah last week. We read about Sarah Imenu. We also read about Sarah the week before. So there are two chapters we've already been speaking about the life of Sarah. And now when we describe the way she died, all of a sudden they decided to call this parasha the life of Sarah. Where is the logic? The answer here. We have a rule. What's the rule? The same thing happened when the life of Yaakov is coming to an end. When Jacob, passed away, the name of the chapter that he passed away, it's Vayechi Yaakov. And Yaakov lived. Why they, instead of saying the past of Yaakov or the past of Sarah, they actually call it the life of Yaakov or the life of Sarah. What is it? The answer is because the righteous people, when they die, they call alive. The wicked people, when they are alive, meaning in this world, they are called dead. Even though they walk here, they talk, they make business, they drive, they dance, they sing, whatever they do, they are considered dead. You understand? They are not alive. But the righteous people, when they died, they consider that they are alive forever. Forever alive. Why is it? You can also see that many of the greatest rabbis in history, they have more attention to them today, 1,000 or 2,000 years after they passed, than they had in their lifetime. I give you an example. The Rambam, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, 850 years ago, he went from Spain to Egypt, and he wrote the most important book, Mishneh Torah, which took him 30 years to write. And that's the foundation of the Shulchan Aruch. He's the biggest posek in the last 1,000 years. Top authority in halacha, in Jewish law. And a very, very important philosopher. And the ideology that we know, many of it came from him. Without him, Judaism had a lot of bald spots. The Rambam was a very, very important foundation in Judaism. Everyone today knows it. You don't have one house without it, and one yeshiva without it, and one synagogue without it. You take Rambam out of Judaism, it's like almost taking the heart out of a person's body. And in his lifetime, he was famous to some people, and he had a lot of opposers. People who hated him very much. Big rabbis were fighting him. He was mukzeh. He had his students, but they burned his books, and they fought him. Why? Because he was bringing a lot of science from the Goyim, from Aristo, and from other things. Spoke a lot about things that the Jewish world were not ready to accept back then. So because of that, they felt that he has apikorsiut, meaning he brings external info that is not coming from Judaism, and they threatened the people to be careful from him, until they actually burned his books. After that, the French Goyim started to burn the Talmud in France. For the first time, they were actually burning holy books. And then Rabbeinu Yonah, that was leading the fight against the Rambam, which was also a giant rabbi back then, also in the same time, he realized his mistake, and he started to go from one synagogue to the other, all over Europe, all over, to tell the people that he made a mistake. That from Shamayim, Hashem is showing us the mistake, that the way we burn his books, now they're burning our books, the Goyim. They didn't burn the Talmud before. So they got the point. And he apologized to him in the public. Yeah, I mean, today he wouldn't have to run. All he would have to do is to publish a short YouTube video, and it would go all over. The biggest rabbi is apologizing to the second biggest rabbi, you know, the two top one, for suspecting him to be an apikores. He will publish a 5 minutes apology, and in 1 week everyone would know about it. But back then there was no communication, no radio, no telephone, no printing, no nothing. So he spent the rest of his life going from one place to another to tell the people that he made a mistake. From one place to another. This is how these people used to be. This is how these people used to be. They had fear from God. These people had fear. They didn't, like today, you can murder a person on the internet, bashing his name, making up lies about him, causing him huge financial damage, or who knows, you know, all kinds of other damages. And then one day you realize you made a mistake, and the reaction is, oh well, I now know that I made a mistake. And what are you going to do about it? I will try not to make another mistake in the future. But what about the tragedy that already took place because of you? Are you going to actually beg someone, you know, for forgiveness? You're going to apologize? Nothing whatsoever. You understand? Because today people have no fear. Almost no one has fear. One of the examples that people have no fear from God is that, you know, if they disagree with the style of a speaker, they don't want him to speak in a place, so they always go to ruin it. Why? You don't have to come. You don't have to come. You don't want to come, don't come. You understand what's going on here or no? 1 second, excuse me, I don't know who's annoying me here. Calling 500 times. Okay, they won't be coming. Okay. I forward him to you. Tov. The righteous people are called live in the Gemara. It's in Masechet Brachot, page 18. Over there you can see the source. V'ayu chaye Sarah, and the life of Sarah is 127 years altogether. We have a rule in life. When usually one very big righteous person is about to disappear, Hashem prepares someone else to take his place, by the men and by the women. Now Sarah is going to take power, to take control. Sarah is moving away from the stage. The Gemara say, until Moshe was ready to go, Yehoshua ben Nun, Joshua, his light was rising. And when Joshua was ready to go, the light of Atniel ben Knaz, the first judge among the judges, was rising. And in the end of the time of the judges, Eli HaKohen, he was the one that Hannah put Shmuel, in, by him to raise him, because she made a vow that if Hashem will give her a boy, she will donate him to the holiness, meaning like to be a monk, a Nazir, to give his life for Hashem. So she put him by Eli. And when Eli was ready to leave, that was the end of the time of the judges. He was a prophet. And Shmuel took over, Samuel. So his light was rising. And now Hashem is taking away Sarah, Rivka is rising. Hine yalda milka gami. Now they're talking about the birth of Rivka. She's getting ready to take the place of Sarah. Vatamot Sarah b'kiryat Arba in Hebron. Sarah passed away in Hebron. So we see from here that Hashem makes sure that the Jewish nation will always have. You're putting, what is he putting? The AC or the heat? You don't know with him. You know, in the summer he can put the heat, in the winter he puts the AC. Very good.
I didn't know I'm that dumb.
You know, I have a lecture actually I made in Belgium on Saturday night. Three different kinds of wisdom. Three. The Gaon Mivilna said, "Yesh shlosha schalim." Person have like three brains, each one for different wisdom. Which are the three? Do you know?
I don't think so.
One is not to react to your comments.
No.
That's number one.
No.
Then it's Chachmah, Binah, and
I tell you what. Tomorrow in Queens, I'm starting a series, a new series. It's been a while since I made a series, you know. What's the series? Psychology of the mind according to the Torah. It's also going to be involved with ideology and wisdom and what really is wisdom and what just look like wisdom to make order in the mind of the people. So maybe tomorrow will be the first session. I will answer about the three different kinds of intelligence and what is the purpose of each one of them. But you know, I give you a little preview how the series is going to start. Hello, hello. You see what happened when you come late? Nobody cares about me anymore. They look over there. There's one thing. Do you think it's possible that a person would sit 2 hours in a lecture without looking at the door once? Huh?
Yes.
When I used to teach in the Yeshiva Gemara, it's the same thing. The door is open, everyone turns around. So I made a rule over there. Everyone would look at the door, will have to pay a serious penalty. You had to see other people were. No, I was just moving, you know. Automatically. To the door. Sometimes it's like this. You sit in the audience, the door is on the side. That's the worst. Why every time the door open, 100 faces. Like this, everything. Like this, the whole night. Left, right, top. I want to ask you a question. There is two statements by the two biggest Chachamim in the last 1,000 years. One is Rambam and one is the Gaon Mivilna. About what is the purpose of life. They asked the Gaon Mivilna, what's the purpose of life? So he answered, Tikkun HaMidot Ze Kol Adam. Correcting your bad traits, that's what the human being is all about. You have to correct your traits, your bad personality, your bad desires, anger, pride, all these things, you have to fix it. The Rambam also say that you have to fix your midot, but he say it differently than Gaon Mivilna. Listen carefully, I want you to answer me what's the difference between Rambam and the Gaon Mivilna. It's thin, very thin. The answer is like this. They ask the Rambam why a person has to fix his midot, that he'll be able to keep the mitzvot of the Torah. They ask the Gaon Mivilna why a person has to keep the mitzvot of the Torah, that it will help him to correct his midot. They both agree that the purpose of a person in this world is to learn Torah all the time. Every day, every open hour, every 10 minutes you have in between things. Constantly to learn Torah. But why you have to learn Torah? Why you have to learn Torah? According to the Rambam, when you learn Torah, you learn about the 613 commandments. And it teaches you how to keep them. And why you need to keep the mitzvot? Well, just to be a robot, to go like this, to go like this. What's the whole purpose of it? That by learning the mitzvot and practicing the mitzvot, it makes you a better human being. It helps you not to be selfish. You learn to respect your parents, to appreciate what they've done for you. You become more generous because it's an obligation to give 10% or 20% from your income. You have to help the poor. You have to save souls of other Jews. All these things force you to change your nature because you're born to the world stingy, but now you want to earn a profit. You want to earn. A lot of stingy people, they invest millions in business. When they write the check in a closing, their heart is burning and their hands are shaking. And his wife is going, don't relax, Itzik, relax, everything is okay. Relax, we're going to make a lot of money. Sign the check. No, you sure, you sure? It's like this. Why? For him to let go of money, it's mamash a torture. The only reason he agree, he won't give $5 to a poor person that he asked him for money. He'll give him maybe a quarter if he's lucky. Why is he writing $1 million investment now, check? Because in his mind, I'm going to make it 3 in a year or two. It's the only reason he let go. But even that is hard for him. So when a person now gives tzedakah to someone, the Torah told him that it's for his own good. You benefit from it. You're not doing it for free. So actually you see that the Torah can take a stingy person and make him very generous. He's starting to give. Why? Because he's earning. So there's a lot of truth in what the Rambam said. Very clever. While you learn Torah, you keep the laws, and while you're keeping the laws, you're fixing your midot. The Gaon Mivilna says, while you're learning Torah, it would lead you to fix your character, your personality, that you will be able to keep the mitzvot. That's what the Rambam says. So according to Rambam, what's the main purpose? To keep the mitzvot. According to the Gaon Mivilna, what's the main purpose? To fix the midot. You understand? Both of them agree you need all three. You must learn Torah, you must keep mitzvot, and you must correct your midot. The only argument here is what was created for what? The mitzvot was created to make you a better person, or you must become a better person that you'll be able to keep the mitzvot. You got the point so far? Repeat.
People have to do three things. One is be unanimous, that they have to learn the Torah. The other thing is to change the midot, or check.
You're lucky. You're lucky you don't play chess like that.
I don't play chess like that. Change the midot, or keep the mitzvot. And the difference is, the one saying is the what comes first and what comes second. One saying is the keeping the mitzvot comes first, and the other one saying is the changing the mitzvot comes first. That's the difference between two of those. And that's it, Ben.
Tov. Today I decided to go on a lenient side with you. Who say who? If he knew, believe me, he would say. That's okay.
That is really important. Who said what?
I tell you what. You see, now I'm coming ready. You take care of the heat. I have a solution.
How do you see how the jacket's coming off? How do you do it to me? Let's see for the majority of people will say it's cold.
You have to go by what the audience want. You're right. Tov.
Now.
Who can tell me the root of the disagreement between the two? When you see two people say something different a little bit than the other, you have to check what actually is the root of the disagreement. Where you can put your finger, where is their opinion actually split?
One is internal and the other external. So the other one says that you have to have mitzvot, and you have to have mitzvot in order to build yourself as a better person. The other says that your focus of using your thought on the inside allows you to go and keep mitzvot. I think that you need mitzvot because if you have the idea that whatever I do is good, for example, you'll ever think. Hitler also thought what he was doing was good. But when you have mitzvot to fulfill, you know exactly what to do because it comes from God.
Okay, so it's true what you say. You didn't answer my question. I will make it a little bit easier. Tell me, please, according to the Rambam, why you have to learn Torah, and according to the Gaon Mivilna, why you have to learn Torah. They both say you have to learn Torah.
One is for keeping the mitzvot, and one is for changing the mitzvot.
Oh, so now you tell me, please, according to the Rambam, that you need to learn Torah. To be able to do what? To be able to keep the mitzvot. Without learning Torah, you won't be able to. And after you're keeping the mitzvot will make you a better person. But according to the Gaon Mivilna, you need to learn Torah to make you a better person. And once you are already a better person, it will be easier for you to surrender and keep the mitzvot. After you became down to earth, your ego went down. Who do you think is right?
Both. It's the same thing.
Like many of the arguments between the Chachamim, it's almost always that they're both right.
But that's the same thing.
They're both right. But we have to understand the logic behind what they say. So the Rambam, according to him, when you learn Torah, it's a matter of education. En amar it's chassid. You cannot be a knowledgeable person if you don't learn your material, right? You cannot be a lawyer without learning law. You cannot be a doctor without learning medicine. The only way for you to be successful in what you want to do is by being knowledgeable. The less ignorant you are, the better you become, which is perfectly fine. Since now you have the knowledge, how to keep the mitzvot, you keep them correctly, and automatically they will actually make you a better person, because the mitzvot, if you look at them, the majority of them is actually a matter of education. Help the poor, help the widow, help the converts, don't take advantage on a convert, you know, sacrifice, you know, if your friend's donkeys collapse, don't ignore him, run and help him out. All these things that we do, it's a matter of fighting our inclination, our evil inclination. So that's the Rambam. Now tell me, please, according to the Gaon Mivilna, what is the purpose of learning Torah?
To change the midot.
How? How you change the midot by learning Torah? I'll ask you a question. Most of the Torah we learn in the yeshivot is Talmud, Gemara, right? Sometimes you can learn 6 months from morning to night matters of money delegation. Now, how is it going to make you a better person? Two people found an object on the street, they both fight. It's mine. You say, no, it's mine. I saw it first. I grabbed it first. No, I grabbed it first. We grabbed it together. All kinds of things like that. Or damages. Neighbor made a damage to his neighbor. Or a keeper did not keep what you let him keep for you correctly. As a result, he caused you damage. All kinds of things like this. Now tell me, please, how does it make you a better person? Oh, see what he said? Very clever. It's very interesting. besides the knowledge, everything you learn will give you knowledge. Everything you learn, math, you'll be a great mathematician. You learn about sports, so you know all the league, the names, the dates. So whatever you learn will give you a power. Knowledge is always power. But if you learn math 7 years straight, it will never make you even 1% a better person. The actual learning will only make you knowledgeable and nothing else. Maybe you'll be successful, you have a career, you make money, that's besides the point. But because you became a great mathematician, it will never make you more generous. It will never make you more down to earth. It will never make you a holier person. There's nothing to do one with the other. If you learn Shakespeare, it will never make you a better human being. You get the detail, the Nobel, whatever it is, that's it. If you learn history of the world, it won't make you a better person. If you learn geometry, it won't make you. If you learn to be a mechanic, an engineer, it will never make you a better person. The only thing that can actually make you a better person is learning Torah. All kind of Torah. It's true that when you learn Musar, ethic, you learn ethics of the Torah, that's the strongest effect that it will have on you. When you learn Musar, what does it mean Musar? You learn that God hates proud people. It's a very good boost for you. I'm like that. I don't want God to hate me. I better start working on myself. So when you acknowledge your problem and you know the consequences of them, that God hates you, even though you do a lot of great things, but he hates you because you're a show-off person, everything by you is show-off, you begin to bring yourself down. You're about to say something, you block your mouth. They ask, who donated this beautiful chandelier to the synagogue? You're about to jump. Me, of course, who else? You remember what you just learned. Wow. Oh, it's really nice. Very nice. Who donated it? I really don't know. What happened? You begin to change. No more show off, no more ego. Your suits from $10,000 go down to $200. You take off your expensive watch and you put the $40 watch that you bought. You know, nothing has already become a show. On your next car, it won't be the best Mercedes. A little Toyota also drives. It begin to change you. This is ethics. You watch your mouth. You don't speak Lashon Hara. You don't murder people with your mouth. You become more generous by helping people with your time, with your money. Ethics, it's like a magic touch. The more you learn, the better you become. But not only that. Ethics is very logical that when you learn it, you become a better person. It's very logical. The more Musar you learn, it makes you a better person. But there are other parts in the Torah that are not ethical, that's not ethic, and when you learn it, they also make you a better person. The question is, how come? If I learn now the measurement of the sukkah, in order for the sukkah to be kosher, how in the world is going to make me a better person? Engineer in college learned the same thing about certain buildings or restaurants. He learned, where should I put the pole? If I put it here, the building collapsed. It has to be 20 feet from here and 20 feet from there. They learn all these things. We also learn about sukkah. It has to have at least 3 walls, and every wall minimum like that, and the height has to be at least like that, or not more than that. Same thing, no? So how does it make a difference? If I learn to be an engineer, of course, everyone agrees it won't make me a better person. But I sit now for 2 hours in yeshiva and learn about the sukkah. I come out of the yeshiva, and I feel I'm ready to occupy the world. With such divine energy I get. What is the secret here? Don't look for logic here. Ethic, it's logical, yes. We're not talking about ethic now. We're talking every Torah you learn. Avraham met Sarah and they got married. You read it from the Torah. The children of Esav. How is it going to make me a better person that I learned the genealogy of Esav? All the names, who gave birth to who? How does it teach me anything? The answer is, the way Hashem made the world when he designed and created the soul, it's too hot here, Michael. It's crazy. Shut it completely.
Finally, people getting warm.
You know what we should do to him? Just open the windows and that's what can he do?
To me?
to you.
I know your tricks. I brought it down, Jack, to me.
Anyway, so, it's really, I cannot breathe. What did you do?
Russia.
Tov. So the answer is, the way Hashem designed the soul, that the soul also needs food. Just like the body needs food, the soul also needs food. And the food of the soul is learning Torah. By feeding the soul, you actually overcome, you melt the power of your evil inclination. Automatically, as a result of that, it's like taking antibiotic against the infection. So it reduces the spiritual infection, which is your desires and bad things. And immediately, it gives you the strength to be able to do everything correctly. That's why when you don't learn a few days, immediately it comes back. So you see, I'll give you an example. You can go to a yeshiva, and you see now at 3 o'clock, they have mincha. But all day from the morning, from 9 in the morning until now, until lunch break, they did not learn ethics at all. They only learn shnayim ochazin betalit, two people fighting over an object that they found. How do we know who to give it to? Should they split it? What does it go by? Who saw it first or who grabbed it first? How would we know? You know? So what does it have to do with becoming a better person, as I said? Nothing. But you have to see how they come to pray. With fire. The way they pray and long and their heart is pure. One day they take off from the yeshiva. Let's see, he didn't feel good today. I was laying in bed. It's not the same. He also come down to pray. It's already not the same. You can see, ask any yeshiva guy will tell you the same thing. On the weeks that they have off from the yeshiva, 2-3 weeks off, they go down to almost zero level. They say, wow, another day or two, if I'm not going back to the yeshiva, I'm going to be, chas v'shalom, becoming chiloni, secular. You understand? That's why some of the yeshiva boys don't leave the yeshiva. Even when they have break, they stay there. They learn on their own. They don't want to come back to Brooklyn, Queens, Manhattan, all these places. Why? They know what's going to be the consequences. They know right away. Going back to what I started, so that was a preview a little bit of what the new series is going to be. About the mind of a person, about also raising children, also taking people out of depression, all these things that are very relevant to our life. Hopefully it will become a successful series like all the other ones were. So, the first verse in the parasha is Vayu Chaye Sara. It starts with the word Vayu. And it finishes Shnei Chaye Sara, the verse. So the answer is Vayu in numeric value is 37. What is the Torah trying to tell us? The last 37 years of Sarah Imenu, of her life. Why they say Shnei Chaye Sarah? Shnei, it means Shnot, the years. The years of the life of Sarah, 127. But also Shnei can be translated to two. Shnei Bakbukim, this is Bakbuk. Two of them, it's Shnei Bakbukim. Shnei Bakbukim, Shnei. But also it can be years. But usually when they use the word years, they say Shnot. They don't say Shnei. Why the Torah wants to say now Shnei instead of Shnot? Everything has a reason. Nothing is coincidental. The answer, Sarah was 90 when she gave birth. Her life is divided to two sections. Until 90 and from 90 and on. When once she had a baby. It's not the same. Until 90, she had one kind of life. Once she gave birth to Yitzchak, her son, right? Her life really began. This is what Rachel said to Yaakov, not Sarah, Rachel. Hava li banim ve'im ayin meta anochi. Give me sons, because if not, I'm dead. From here, the Gemara says someone who has no children is also considered dead. Even if he's very righteous, he's not wicked, he keeps mitzvot, it's not up to him. He does everything he can to get married, but he never got married. Or he got married and he cannot have children. Today, a couple that couldn't have children for 30 years finally had a boy today. After 30 years of trying. Miracles happen sometimes. So the answer is, there are a group of people who are considered dead. One of them is blind. He cannot see color, cannot see everywhere he goes, nothing. Second one is someone that is poor. He lost all his money. Cannot buy tefillin, cannot do anything. Even food for Shabbat he cannot afford. His life, even spiritually, is already not worth a lot. There's nothing he can do. And one is someone that doesn't have kids. What about someone who doesn't have a wife, doesn't have a woman in his life? The Gemara says, "Sharui belo isha, sharui belo bracha." It doesn't say it's considered dead, but someone who doesn't have a wife, meaning he has no blessing in his life. But some people would swear to you it's the other way around. Like they made in Israel a little correction to the verse of King Solomon. King Solomon wrote, "Matza isha matza tov." You found a woman, you found greatness, you found good. And the Israelis added another part to that sentence, "Matza isha matza tov, lo matza od yoter tov." So he didn't find even better. But that's not what the Torah says. That's the people who wants to comfort themselves. So the idea is, also King Solomon say, "Motze ani ta'isha mar mimavet." Women can be more worse than poison. So what do we know? It all depends what kind of woman you have. You have Eshet Chayil or Hashem Yirachem what you have. Some wives will spend their life with you in a mall or in vacation. Take me here, take me there, it's Sunday. I want you to be with the kids, let's go here, let's go there, you're so boring, you're getting old. You know, so obviously he's living to entertain her. "Where else do you want me to take you, darling? Today we're going away for 3 days, I made reservation." Top, finish with this nightmare, right away she comes back, "Let's go, there's a sale in Macy's." Okay, another 8 hours. "No, tomorrow, what's next? I'm not happy for my cleaning lady. It's not enough, I need another one." "No problem. The babysitter is not good like she used to be. We need another one." "Okay, I don't like the house, it's too small for us." "What do you mean, it's 10,000 square feet? But your brother just bought 30,000 square feet. You're making more money than him, no?" That's the wife that the Torah say worse than poison. Wait a minute. Who said poison is bad? Eat it. No problem.
It's a particular complaint and at least easy to address that. How about this? "I don't know, you don't make me happy. I'm not happy with the life I have."
No, but that, on that part she could be right. On that part she could be right. It doesn't give her attention.
She said, "I'm not happy."
Not happy financially?
I don't know why I'm not happy. I'm not happy.
We got the point.
The point is, give me
some
house. Give me house, give me this. And what you can do, you can give a time frame and say, "Okay, next year we'll buy a house. Next month I buy you a bag. Whatever
you're going to buy to your wife, it will never ever make her happy for more than a day or two."
That's why you promised next year, so it's only years are coming.
No, because you have to understand one thing about buying. It's not really what you buy, it's why did you buy. Did you buy because you had to or because you thought of me? That's really what counts. So therefore, even if you give her a flower, the fact that you thought of her is more than anything else. That's the idea that many men do not understand. But let's move on with with what we started.
Let's move on.
It's a good idea.
I gotta tell you something, you know. One second. You know, one guy, it was cheap. He didn't give his wife anything. She was complaining. So the rabbi told her, give me the worst thing that you ever had with this stinginess. So she said, one time we went with a cab, and in the middle of the way, the driver was going down to, off the cliff. But he started to scream, stop, stop! So the driver said, I'm trying, you fool, I'm trying to stop. He said, no, stop the meter. We're going down, at least don't charge me for that. All right, let's move on. So the life of Sarah, the reason they broke it to the word Shnei, meaning besides her life, the years, is that up to 90 and from then on, that she finally had the boy. But it's very interesting because women don't have any obligation to have children. Man has obligation to have children. He has to have at least a boy and a girl. Everything else is extra. But women don't have an obligation to get married. It doesn't say that a woman is not perfect if she doesn't have a man. She can be alone all her life and happy. But on the Gemara in Masechet Kiddushin, it actually says that a woman will do everything she can to be married. Yeah, not, as long as she doesn't stay alone. Even if she doesn't like the guy so much. If she see that it didn't work out for her, he's rich, he's a good man, marry him, she agrees. Many of the women in the world, millions, married a man that they never loved. It's very interesting. I mean, trying to think about it, how can it be such thing? Especially in this generation, that a woman would agree to be 30, 40 years in the same room with a person she doesn't even love, just because he bought her a house, or I don't know, or he's going to raise her children from first marriage. She had obviously had something in mind, or just because she didn't want to be alone in a place between four walls. I don't know. I mean, it's for me, it sounds a little bit unbelievable, but this is what the Gemara says. A woman will do everything she can not to stay alone. You know? One more thing. Sarah, her life is over. She's 127 years old. Vatamot Sarah. She passed away. ויבוא אברהם לספוד לשרה ולבכותה. Abraham came to make a eulogy for Sarah and to cry, meaning he's mourning right now. The Gemara in Masechet Sanhedrin, page 22, the Gemara says, אין איש מת אלא לאשתו, ואין אישה מתה אלא לבעלה. A man, when he dies, from all the people in the world, who suffers the most? His wife, more than his parents, more than his children, more than his best friends. The wife suffered the most, unless if it was a monster who tortured her. Then she opened the champagne. It's a different story. We're talking when she loved him, he was a good man, and he passed away from sickness or something, she suffered the most. And it's the other way around also. Man that his wife was good, respect, help, raising the children, being a good wife, you know, everything that a woman needs to do. And she died, that's heartbreaking for the men. I saw a few times in my life a couple that one of them died, the other one became old within weeks, by maybe 10 years, like gray hair and, you know, totally or lost a lot of weight as a result of this sadness. That's why that one of the things that they do right away when a man loses his wife, to encourage him to get remarried right away. The faster, the better. Why? Because the psychology of a person is that as soon as he finds a replacement, even though it's hard for him in the beginning, after a while, slowly, slowly forget the past and get used to the present. That's what I always tell people that go on a date and the date went sour. And they took it to the heart. Wow, she didn't want me. Oh, he didn't want me. I said, and sometimes you get to a situation that one of the two fall in love with the other one. Let's say they went 2 months on dates, and he's actually already in love with her. But she wasn't sure. And then in the end she said to the Shatran, I don't want to do it, I'm not sure, I want to cut it off. So one side is more sensitive sometimes, it's taking to the heart. Some people are obsessive also. I know a guy that he fell in love with a girl, she didn't want him, and then she left him. He did not leave her alone. She met a new guy. She got engaged, still didn't leave her alone. She got married. He was planning to go to the wedding and the night of the wedding until somebody called me and told me about his plan to ruin the wedding. He couldn't live with the fact that she's getting married to someone else. He was ready to go into the chuppah and scream over there and say that there's a bomb there. You had to see how I was convincing this guy not to do it and giving him speech after speech all day until he promised me that he won't do it. He just couldn't let go. There are people like this also. It's very scary how people sometimes react. So, the Gemara says, the solution really is right away when you went on a sour date and it didn't work out, to try right away to find another date. Because if you find another girl that you would like, immediately she can make you forget the last one. If you don't find, then you can sit home for months and thinking, what if, how it could be, how it would be, how did she do such thing? You know, it never leaves you alone. That's also what Sata Yetzirah. The Yetzirah is very happy that a person sit and sad. He's very happy, the Satan, to make a person sad no matter what. When you're sad, your spirituality is going down. You cannot be sad and go up in Avodat Hashem. Once you're sad, you cannot become more righteous, only worse. Why? If you're a prophet, your prophecy disappears. Sadness and anger, those are the two enemies. If you're sad, you're down, you're going down. If you're angry, you're going down. I want to add to that, also if you're Mr. Proud, full of pride, Mr. Show Off, you're also going down. Why? Because you think I'm the God. Very difficult to elevate yourself spiritually when that's the way you feel. The woman, Rabbi Yochanan says, is described saying goodbye between a man to his wife. It says like this, Kol Adam, this is the same page in the Gemara, Kol Adam shemeta ishto rishona bechayav, keilu charav bet hamikdash beyamav. Every person that his first wife, meaning first marriage, his wife died, keilu charav bet hamikdash beyamav. That the temple, it's like the temple destroyed in his lifetime. That's how he feels. Today, we don't even have even 1% of understanding about the sadness and the destruction that people had when the temple destroyed. Because most people don't even know what the temple was. 99 out of 100 Jews on the street, they don't even know what the temple was. They don't even know it was in Jerusalem. They don't know it was in the Moriah Mountain. They don't know it was full of Kohanim and Levim, and there was a choir and music and lots of gold and beautiful places and the sacrifice. They don't know all of it. Most of the Jews don't know it. Ask any Israeli secular what was in Beit HaMikdash. Well, he won't know. What was that? Prayers? They used to pray? What did they do? He won't know. And even among religious people, they know what Beit HaMikdash was in general, but they don't know exactly the way it was, with the sheaf, what took place in the holidays, what's the Kohen Gadol, with the clothing. They don't know about the ceremonies, about the things in Yerushalayim back then, and what's the ceremony of Yom HaKippurim, and with the two goats. Lots of the things there used to be, and the smoke used to go like a pillar, mamash straight, even though it was a windy day. Never they saw a fly over there, never. Today you go to a butcher shop, no matter how clean they try to keep it, you always have tons of flies. Fly comes to where blood is. They cut me, there's tons of blood. It's normal that flies goes there. You cannot prevent it. In Beit HaMikdash, hundreds of years, not one fly was found. One of the miracles that people saw with their own eyes. the smoke that came out from the sacrifices, obviously when you have a windy day, the smoke goes up and spreads everywhere. It used to go up mamash like one line. All the miracles that took place in Beit HaMikdash, the Gemara describe it. The more you know about it, the more you understand what we lost. Like everything else in life, right? We'll continue. Now Avraham wants to buy a place to bury Sarah. The Chachamim are asking, Ephron Achiti was the owner of the land. He keeps saying to Avraham Avinu, I'm giving you the Me'arat HaMachpelah, the cave, for free. How Avraham all of a sudden offered him 400 shekel kesef? How did Avraham offer him such a big amount of money? You know, it's the same place you go in Hebron, you see the big place, Me'arat HaMachpelah. That's what we're talking here about. According to the New Testament, somehow it's written over there that it's in a different city, Nablus, Shechem. That's one of the proofs that the New Testament is baloney. It's not from God. People wrote it up and it's full of human errors. That God knows where Abraham is buried. How all of a sudden in the second book it's now in a different city? Every fool knows it's in Hebron. Every generation he was there. Every generation. We have books from every generation in the last 3,000 years. Speaking about people that goes to pray there. So it's not that he was moved and was returned, obviously. All right, so it says like this. I'm giving it for you for free. Take it for free. Chachamim explained, Ephron gave Avraham a hint. He said to him, Eretz 400 shekel kesef ben you ven chamai. 400 shekel between me, let's say $400,000 between me and you, it's peanuts. They're both rich people. He's rich and Avraham is very rich. So what is it? It's like Warren Buffett and Donald Trump sitting together and he wants to give him, he likes something in his vase. $400,000. And you know, like they do business. What is it between me and you? $400,000. Take it. No, let me send you the check. Don't bother. He won't call him tomorrow. Where is the check? But over here, Ephron would definitely call. The Gemara say, you know what's the difference between righteous and wicked people? Righteous people talk a little bit and do a lot. They speak a little bit, but they do a lot more. Wicked people, they speak a lot, and even a little bit they don't do. Rabbi, I want to donate. If every time I heard that sentence, it would really happen, wow, we'd have another 2 million Balei Tshuva today. I want to do this and I want to do that. I'm selling the house, I'm going to sell. Good thing they don't see how I smile when I hear it. It's not that I don't mean it, don't get me wrong. People mean it. But once the time comes, nothing. You know, somebody who was sued by people and he lost the case. Many, many millions of dollars he had to pay to few crooks. He was not guilty. Those were a bunch of crooks who took advantage on his good heart and they wanted to take money out of him. And he went to the stupid court here in America and they found him guilty. But much strange.
Not guilty, liable.
Liable. For you, liable.
Not for me, for the purpose of...
No, guilty of what they claim he did. That's what it means. Liable for the money, but guilty by what they claim he did. Why they sue him? They claim he did something wrong. Okay. So, he appealed. He had to appeal. The lawyer told him the chance that the appeal would succeed is 2%. 1 to 50. 50 appeals, 1 win. Very small chance. And to appeal, the lawyers take hundreds of thousands of dollars. The lawyers always make the most. Divorce case, they make the most. The litigation, that's how it goes. So I remember he said to all kinds of people, pray for me. If I win, 70% of the money I will give anyway to donations, to charity. I will give him, I will give you. So we all prayed for him. So one of my students told me, wow, if he wins, he's going to give you a lot of money.
Yeah.
I said to him, if you give me the money, whatever he gives me, I'll give you from my own pocket. So you're crazy? I'm going to give you hundreds of thousands of dollars. I said to him, after he will win, and he will win, he will not give a penny. He said, why, stingy? I said, not at all. He's a very generous person. I said, so what's the problem? He's not a bad person. He's a fantastic person. I love him very much. Great heart. And generous also. So what's the problem? I said, if he had the merit to give me, he would give me all the years we know each other. The fact he never gave for Kiruv, that's a sign that he doesn't have the merit. When he will get the money, he will build probably another synagogue. He will give to all kinds of places, to the poor people. To Kiruv, he will not give. And that's exactly what happened. Just as I told him. You understand? Because to give to Kiruv, you have to really be somebody that Hashem loves. Because all other investment is a one-time profit. The money is gone. Whatever you made, and it's finished. Over here, it's residual, eternal income. Remember this sentence. Residual, meaning constant, all the time. Eternal income. It will never stop. While you're making one Baal Tshuva, every time he does something good, it goes to your account. But you only gave him money 20 years ago. You gave him 10 CDs, you bought it. You gave him $10, and he became religious. And now it's 20 years later. You don't even know where he is. You don't need to. Hashem knows the calculation. Everything, 100%. Continue to go to your account. And then one day as children, whatever they do goes to your account. They go to Talmud Torah, they learn all day Torah, goes to your account. Their grandchildren also, the grand-grandchildren. Where will you ever find such an investment? You know, you go on the street, you give out CDs, you put some here, you put there. People take, they become religious. You are king in the next world. All you need to do is to create one Baal Tshuva, like the Zohar said. One. With your effort. One, you make religious one person, I was already better than your entire 8 years of life as a religious person. One person you made religious, the Zohar say, for that it was worth to run after a person 70 years, to run after him like you run after life. Meaning if a person has a disease, and they tell him somewhere in the world there's a doctor who has the cure for your disease. Well, we don't know really where. What will he do? Like crazy, runs everywhere. I think he's in Austria. Right away, the next day he's on the way to Austria. Where is this? Where is this doctor? No, he's not here. Oh, he's in Japan. No problem. He will go to Japan. 7 years he would run just to find the cure, not to die. He will be dead by then. You understand the idea here or no? That's how much people would have to do to run after a secular person to make him religious. One, talking about one. And today you can do thousands, mamash, easy. One, two, three, it's a game of number. We, Bezrat Hashem, now, we finished the 1 million CDs in Israel, now we're going to make another 500,000. Why we don't make another 1 million? Because now we're also giving a lot of these USBs. USB has about 1,000 hours of films and lectures in Hebrew, USBs. I have some here in English, in Hebrew if you want. We sell them for $20. It's about 1,000 hours, 32 gigabytes, but from the donations, we give it to secular people for free. In the lectures in Israel, we give a lot of them for free. Why is it? Because if a person gets it, he puts it in a car, it starts from Torah and science, and then life after death, the debate, Shabbat, all the lectures for beginners, which is also good for more advanced people. But for beginners, it opens up their eyes to know the Torah is from God. Proof, scientific proof. It's very easy after that to listen to the rest, knowing it's all real. If it's only a matter of faith, it's very difficult to change. Right? If a person is dating a non-Jewish woman, why would he leave her? He's in love with her. She gives him pleasure. He enjoys to be with her. Why in the world he will give her because one religious person told him that it's a sin? He has to be a fool to listen to him. I may lose a lot more than the chance to gain. But if he knows 1,000,000% that that's what God says, and is very angry at him every second he's with her, that's a different story, you have to agree, no? If somebody would tell you, next time I see you next to her, you get a bullet to your head. Christine, I'm so sorry. What happened? I don't want to die, with all due respect. You want me dead? No, no, I also love you. I also don't want you to die. Okay, I live without you. What made the separation? Not that they wanted. He was afraid to get a bullet to his head. And I promise you, the bullet is peanuts compared to their next world, what they're going to pay for. If you read in a Zohar, what's the punishment of people who went with other people from other nations? You have no idea what it says. Mamash scary. And I know people don't know, but people that are not aware doesn't mean it changed reality. If you drive in certain places in Jersey, sometimes they have a little sign on the side, double fine. Points, double fine. If you didn't see the sign, you're driving 100 miles an hour, you're going to be able to read the sign? And they pull you over. Wow, you can get arrested. Some countries, they take away your car. If you go over a certain speed, too fast, they take you off the car right away to jail and they pound the car. $100,000 car, you lost it. They take it away. Every place with its rules, you know. In Mexico, you have nothing to worry. Just make sure you have $5 in your pocket always. ¿Cómo está, señor? Rápido, rápido, muchacho. No, no problema, señor. Cerveza on the house. Sí, señor. No problem. You understand? But not every place is Mexico. Tov, where were we? Tov. So Ephron is hinting to Avraham. What is he hinting to Avraham? He says, Eretz 400 shekel kesef benyu ven chamai. What is that, you know? So, Avraham, you know, it's like this. Ephron, the letter in the word Ephron in the middle is resh. It's 200, resh in numeric value. And the middle letter in Avraham, it's also resh. The middle letter, Avraham, Aleph Bet, right? Av, resh, like comes the third letter, and then there's two more letters, two letters from both sides. Resh, 200. Also Ephron. Ephron, Ayin, Pei, Resh, Vav, Nun. Two letters from the left, two letters from the right, the middle letter is Resh. Resh and Resh, 400. So he say to him, Beni u Bencha, what's between your name and what's between my name, together it's how much? 400. He's hinting to him. Sheneemar, Vaishma Avraham el Ephron. Avraham Avinu was very, very smart and clever. He got the hint. Beini uvencha. Right away, he started to count 400 shekel from the Me'arat HaMachpelah. Vaishkol Avraham le'Ephron 400 shekel kesef over la'socher. Avraham counted 400 shekel to give it to him, 400 coins. And now it says, over la'socher. What is this expression, over la'socher? Going to the hand of the trader. Person who trade with something. So where else is going to go? To the trees? To the moon? Of course he goes to this hand. Why do I have to write over la'socher? Very interesting. The Chachamim were asking about this. Rav Yonatan Eifshitz from Prague, this is what he said. He lives about 200 and over 200 years ago. He says, according to the law, you're not allowed to give to a goy coins of pure gold and pure silver. Why? You're not allowed to give it to a goy. Chris wants to sell you something, you have to pay him now. If you give him 400 coins of gold or silver, it's a problem. Why it's a problem? Because they used to melt it and make idols with it. They melt it, And they make their idols. You go to India, you see all these gold, big things. In India, they have big temples, and they put huge idols, like 30, 40 feet tall, with lots of gold and silver. So, and they make the entrance to the temples very, very short. So yeah, in order for you to come in, you have to bend down like this, and you come in, and by the time you raise your face, you already bow down to their idol. So the Israelis, as usual, they found a way around it. They all come in reverse. Well, you want to force me to bow down to your idol? I have my own ways. Understand? So what does it mean, over la socher? It's special coins, I guess with stamps on it, that has a bigger value for business. Those kinds of coins, they would not melt. So Avraham made sure to give him from those coins. Otherwise, you can give him from the other kind. But he made sure he won't use it for Avodah Zarah. Avraham zaken baba yamim. And Avraham is old, coming with lots of days in his past, meaning. The Rebbe from Gur, Rabbi Yehuda Leib, the Sfat Emet, was a super, super, super genius. You learn his commentaries on the Gemara, on the Talmud, Sfat Emet, you get shocked. What a brain he had. Amazing. He said, Baba Yamim, when a person brings his entire life with him, you walk into the room, you're 80 years old, you bring now 80 years of legacy, of doing, of succeeding, or whatever. You bring it with you. Avraham is a person never wasted a day of his life. There are many giants in history, not many, but compared to the world, there are not many, but still, that were like that, like King David, people who took advantage on every day of their life. The Gaon Mivilna, before he passed away, he said, he was holding a tzitzit and crying. I ask him, why are you crying? He said, I'm living a world that every second you can make a mitzvah doing nothing for 20 ruble. You wear a tzitzit, every second mitzvah. How can I not cry? I was thinking already the calculation. Every day of my life is thousands of mitzvot just from this tzitzit. So obviously I want to live a few more days. There's already going to be another million mitzvot. This is how he was calculating every second. There were some big rabbanim before they died. They say about the Chafetz Chaim, maybe it was someone else, that he was able to say that his entire life he wasted more than 2 hours, 2.5 hours in his entire life. That he cannot say what he did in this time. Every other time was always calculated not to waste a minute. Today, without discipline and a correct schedule, it's very difficult to succeed. Very difficult. If a person every day do something else, one day goes to yeshiva in this time, one day that time, one day is praying in this time, one day in that time, everything by him, like they say in Israel, Mashe Baba, whatever happened, happened. Meaning, I let destiny move me as time goes by. Someone called me up, come, there is a game. That means Hashem wants me to be there, let's go. Come, we're playing cards for money. Come, there's a chance for you to make money. But you also more can lose money. Come, join us. I guess Hashem wants me to go there. Whatever people offer him, whatever he sees, whatever happened to in his life, he follow. Like a robot. That's not a successful life. You have to determine your life. Not life have to determine your schedule. You have to make your schedule, you have to know what never to waste time on. For instance, birthday party. Nothing more foolish than that. Why didn't you come to the lecture? We went to a birthday party. Birthday party? That's, if it's a kid, anyway, you won't remember you came to this birthday party. If it's an old person, what old person make a birthday party? Is losing life and he's making a party? The battery just went another percent down. You make a party when your phone battery goes down? You get nervous, no? One way or the other, even if it was mitzvah to go to a birthday party, You compare this to go to a lecture? So birthday party off the schedule for the rest of your life. What other things? A lot of other things. Bar mitzvah. Bat mitzvah, there's nothing to talk about, bichlal. There's no such thing. The Israelis made it up, bat mitzvah. That the girls won't complain. But bar mitzvah. Somebody has a bar mitzvah in your family. The nephew of the daughter of the uncle of your father. You just happen to know that they have some kind of connection to you today. So they invited you to the bar mitzvah. 3 hours to get there, 2 hours to come back. Another 3 hours to be there, 8-9 hours to waste time over there. Any mitzvah? None. Not even one. 8 hours you learn, 60,000 mitzvot an hour, multiply by 8, 480,000 mitzvot for not going to the bar mitzvah. Wedding, also don't go. Only to your own brother and sister and mamash, the closest relative to you. Nothing. Don't waste time. Take advantage on life. Life is short. It's a blink of the eye. I promise you one thing. All the people who go to weddings, to bar mitzvah, to birthday parties, they will cry for every minute. I promise you this. Men and women. When they come to the next world. First, most of the time it's not modest. You know, I was invited to speak in Manhattan Beach Synagogue. Last Sunday, what was that, 10 days ago? 10 days ago. I've never been in that place. It's in Manhattan Beach. Huge place, the whole block. So when I got there, I saw, you know, valet parking guys, maybe 8 or 9 guys standing on the stand to park your car for you. It's a problem with parking over there. I say to myself, I knew that I was invited to an event, but I didn't think it's going to be such a huge event. I see from the windows all kinds of lights and I hear music. I know it's fundraising. I say, okay, no. I walk in. I ask the guy, where is the place of the speech? There's a black guy there, standing over there, going, where is the place of the speech? He said, go talk to, I don't know, John, whatever. I thought maybe, go over there. I turn around, I walk 5 steps, I almost fainted. 500 guys, girls, Sodom and Gomorrah, all Jews. Jewish wedding, worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. Goyish music, everyone with alcohol. That's how Jews getting married. It was a tragedy. Marriage? I almost fainted. I said, now what should I do? Should I turn around and leave? I don't know, it's a wedding yet. That's the whole point. I didn't know it's a wedding. I thought that's where I was invited to talk. So I say to the guy, when is the speech starting? So he looks at me and says, you're Rabbi Mizrahi, right? I say, yes. He say, well, you came about an hour and a half late. The chuppah was at 7:30. I say, chuppah? They didn't tell me it's a wedding. I said to myself, something is not right here. I go up back to the black guy. He said, tell me, there's another floor here in this building? He said, yeah, upstairs. I go upstairs. I see Chatan and Kala in a room. Kala, Hashem Yirachem, how she dressed. Right away, I said to myself, okay, that's a wedding here. Right away, quickly, I ran outside of the building. So one of the guys that parks the car, he said to me, Rabbi, what are you looking for? So I say to him, I was supposed to give a lecture here, but I see there's a wedding here. So he said to me, oh, I think I know. You have to go all the way to the end of the block, make a left. There is another place, but all the way there. By the time I got there, the woman was looking for me. Where are you? I said, well, how am I supposed to know? So I went there, and there was the event over there. There's another hall. It's a huge place. But this was the wedding. All the people who goes there, they all go to Gehinnom, what do you think? Just for participating in such a wedding. Mixed men, women, mixed wedding. You know what I cannot understand? The Hamas murderer. All the Hamas members are all murderers. They murder women, they murder children, they're very cruel people. They murder their own people. They also murder Palestinians. As a matter of fact, they murder more Palestinians than they murder Jews. They try to murder more Jews, but you know, Hashem protects us. And there's a war, and it's very difficult for them to get to Jews. It's borders, the security. They try all the time. But the point is that everybody understands that they are monster murderers. Everybody understands. So the question is, how is it possible that they understand more than us what a mixed wedding is? They'll never let anyone get married mixed by Gaza. One time, you can check on YouTube, they had a wedding. The men all the way there. The women all the way there. But they play music loud. The men were dancing. And the women in a different place dancing. I don't know what they wanted from them. Totally separate. Two jeeps came with machine guns. They came out, they shot and they killed everyone. In YouTube, you can see it. Why? It wasn't modest enough for the murderers. I say to myself, what a shame for us. Mamash busha v'cherpa. We go to weddings like a million times worse than the one they killed those people. Imagine if there would be like this wedding that I went to. As soon as I walked, I almost fainted just being there. Exactly 20 seconds I was in. I almost fainted. You feel the impurity, the tum'ah of the people of the place over there with all the show and the buffet and all these gowns. The Jews went to the meal of Ahasuerus. It was glad kosher, separate section for the Jews. Totally glad kosher, separate section. Mordechai, the chief rabbi, was standing by the door crying to the people not to go in. And some of them went in anyway. And for that, even though it was separate, and I promise you one thing over there, the Jews back then were much more religious than the Jews today. Because when Haman came to Ahasuerus, there is a weird nation, their language is different, their religion is different than us, their customs is different, their clothes are different. Give me permission to kill them. I'll pay you tons of money for it. This is how man presented his strategy to destroy the Jewish nation. And from the language of the Ahasuerus with Haman, meaning that's how the Jews were. They all were different than the Goyim. None of them dressed like the Goyim. And none of them behave like the Goyim. And they went to a glad kosher separate section for Jews only. And the rabbi was standing over there, he said, it's not for us to participate in such a party. And Hashem decided that a Holocaust will take place to the Jewish nation just because the Jews participated in a party of this wicked king. That's it. Nothing else. They did not make sex crimes. They did not eat anything not kosher. There was no goyish music in their section. It was all separate Jewish section. Otherwise, how they will invite them? And the rabbi was standing by the door begging them not to go in. They went in and a Holocaust came to the world. And only a miracle prevented it in the last minute. It was already signed and sealed and sent out. All over, the messages were all over, the Goyim has to wait for this date, and at that day they go on the street and they kill all Jews. That's the order. Every Jew you see, you kill that day. You don't have to worry, you don't have to get punished, nothing. You have to do what the king says. It's written by the king, meaning it was already sealed, finished. And then the miracle happened. Everything was reversed in the last minute. But what do you see from here? That just from going to a party that it's not smell good, not to talk about the ones they make today, the mixed weddings and the horrible bar mitzvahs and all this, there's a huge price to pay. Why? Hashem hates zima. Elokim sone zima, men, women, mingling by the bar, all these things that the Goyim invented, Hashem hates it very much. I know, American Jews, they thinking, what's the big deal? I only had a drink with the guy and spoke a little bit about how much money he makes. What do you do?
I was looking for your video, I'm sorry.
I know. Rabbi, it sounds like someone came to kill me over there. A bomb or something. You got the point or no? Yeah.
I know it's not allowed. However, I'm thinking, could it be that there are some people that they just, that they're chafim mipesha because they don't know?
Innocent.
Like how bad it is. And they don't, I know they don't do it on purpose to lachis, to Hashem. They don't want to get Hashem angry, they just don't know.
We're not talking about people who don't know. We're talking about people like us that knows. A lot of religious people go to mixed weddings. They go. Why? Because it's family. That's their excuse. My father asked me to go. So what? Your father in heaven told you not to dare to step there. Your father over here, he doesn't know the rules. So that's why he wants you to go. But your real father told you don't dare to stand in a place like that. Why are you going? Not to talk about going to pools and beaches and Shem Yirachem. That's the problem here. One more thing, time is running out. The three Jewish fathers, each one of them has a verse in the Torah that they were blessed. With Abraham, it says, Hashem berach et Abraham bakol. And Hashem bless Abraham in everything. In Yitzchak, it says, Vayaveli vauchal mikol. And in Yaakov, it says, Ki chanani Elokim v'chiyesh li kol. That's why we say in Birkat Amazon, bakol mikol kol. It's strange language. What is this? Bakol mikol kol. Bakol Abraham. Mi kol Yitzchak, kol Yaakov. Kol means everything. Hashem bless me in everything. Bakol in everything. Mi kol from everything. Kol means everything. A little bit different language in each one of the fathers. But Hashem bless them in everything. Why? They deserved it. This is what we say in the fourth blessing of the benching of Birkat Amazon. Bakol mi kol kol, ken yivarech otanu yachad v'chule. והשם ברך את אברהם בכל, בכל, in numeric value, it's 52. 52, numeric value, Ben, a boy. בכל, meaning once you have a boy, you never had a boy, now you have a boy, you have everything. Finally, you have someone to take over what you leave. So it's very good. The Gemara in Masechet Baba Batra, page 16, Chazal said, there's a secret here, Avraham also had a daughter. Her name was Bakol. Bakol. Avraham had a daughter. I know some of you got shocked now, but yes, not everything is written in a written Torah, some of it comes from the oral Torah, the secrets. But how did the Chachamim knows about it when it's not written in a Torah? The answer, the Gemara in Masechet Yevamot, page 6, the Gemara says, Bet Shammai say, to have mitzvah pru urvu, you need two boys. At least two boys. And Bet Hillel, a boy and a girl. Right? Zachar u'nekeva. How does Bet Shammai learn that you need two boys? That Moshe Rabbeinu had two boys, and he separated himself from his wife. If he needed a girl at least, how would he had no permission to separate from his wife. He did not fulfill the mitzvah yet. He cannot separate until he has at least one girl. That's, by the way, women that get permission from rabbis to get birth control, for all kinds of reasons, she just gave birth, she has mental breakdown, depression, who knows what. First question the rabbis ask, if they have a boy and a girl. If the answer is yes, it's much, much more lenient to give them permission to use birth control. If they don't have a boy and a girl, unless if it's really, really a mental crisis or something mamash dangerous, they will never give them permission. They must have at least a boy and a girl. But they have seven boys. Too bad, I cannot give you any time out from giving birth. Why? You still don't have the girl. So Bet Shammai say, how would Moshe separate from his wife when he has two boys and never had a girl? From here you learn that two boys, it's not enough. Two boys, it's enough. From here you learn. But Bet Hillel says, Zachar u'nekeva Abraham. It's a verse in the Torah. A boy and a girl were created. It's in Genesis 5, verse 2. just like Hashem created man and a woman, you only have the fulfillment of the mitzvah of pruvu, multiply and have children, by having a boy and a girl. And the law is like Bet Hillel, always. Whenever there's disagreement with Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel, there's always halacha like Bet Hillel. So, since the Torah say that Abraham kept all the mitzvot of the Torah, with no exception, then he had to have mitzvah of Pruvu. And if he had only Yitzchak and Ishmael, he had to have a girl, because it says in the Torah that he kept all the mitzvot of the Torah. So from here, they learned that he also had a daughter. Then the Midrash came and said that her name was Bakol and all of that. Mamash, before we finish, Amar Rabbi Yudan Barabbi Simon, three places the world cannot cheat the Jewish nation about it. Three things. They cannot say to the Jewish nation, you stole it from us. We're talking real estate now, property. They come and say, you stole Israel from us, you did this, you did that. They're always full of complaints. Right? The three things that they can never complain to the Jewish nation for stealing it from them is, one, Me'arat HaMachpelah, the cave that Abraham bought from Ephron with 400 shekel. So you see in the Torah that it was a legal deal. He bought it with money, our father. And the second one is the temple that was built on the Moriah mountain in a property that David HaMelech bought from Arvana Yevusi. There were seven nations over there in Israel. One of them was the Yevusi. Prizi, Girgashi, Knaani, Yevusi, Chiti, Chivi. All these nations were there. Seven nations. One of them were the Yevusi. There was Arvana. There was a rich guy, David HaMelech, bought the property in the Moriah mountain from him 3,000 years ago. As it's written in the end of Samuel B. It's written clearly that David bought it with money, with cash from him. And the grave of Yosef. The grave of Yosef. It's in Nablus, in Shechem, the place where the grave of Yosef is. It was bought by Yaakov Avinu from Hamor, the father of Shechem. Why the city called Shechem? Because Shechem was the one who raped Dinah, the daughter of Yaakov. And his father was named Hamor, donkey. Hamor. Hamor in Hebrew means donkey. Back then he didn't mean donkey. He wouldn't call himself donkey. You understand? So, it says that Yaakov bought the property from the father of Shechem. Shechem is the one who raped his daughter. Before of that, he bought the property from his father, Hamor. Meaning three properties that are holy to the Jewish nation were bought legally by our fathers. And guess what? All three were stolen by the Arabs. They claim belongs to them. Even though they read in the Torah that the Jews bought it, they stole it. Me'arat HaMachpelah, they made a mosque over there. Jews are afraid to go there. You need to go with military. You cannot go on your own there. The grave of Yosef, few times they burn it. They put Palestinian flag, they painted it green. You cannot go to the grave of Yosef. The Breslev guys, they risk their life every once in a while, they go in the middle of the night. Just a week ago, they went, the Arabs shot them, they get arrested. You're not allowed to go. You don't have to go, you have to arrange it with the military. The Arabs don't let you come there. That's the way it is until Mashiach comes. And Beit HaMikdash, they build their mosque over there in our temple. And they claim now, with the help of United Nations, the anti-Semites, that the temple was never there. The Jews have no connection to Jerusalem. Look at how fake these wicked goyim are, these Arabs, that they will change the whole history for their agenda. What about the divine truth? You're going against clear verses in the Torah that you yourself admit that is the book of God. That's why you call yourself Ibrahim. That's why you call yourself Yusuf. Where these names come from? The Torah, no? So you admit that is the word of God, but only what's comfortable for you. What you don't like, you ignore. Arabs. But But the Arabs, they have one thing about them, you cannot take it from them. What? They multiply a lot. Each family, 8 kids and up. 8, 17. I'll show you a video now. One Arab has more than 100 kids. Hundreds of kids. He came to the Jew, the American Jew, is a host. He's interviewing him. I have the video here. How many wives you have, he asked him. He said, one. How many wives you have? 40, 50. And then from each one, he has 10, 15, 12 kids. He has a tribe. Bin Laden had a tribe. Bin Laden has 130 or 140 kids back then. That's how they almost 2 billion people, 1.8 billion people. Gaddafi, you know Gaddafi? That was the king of Libya.
He was a Jew.
And they say he was a Jew.
He was.
Everything is possible. Gaddafi, he had a house in Englewood, over there. He's a neighbor of Shmuli Boteach. They will also be neighbors in the next world. Oy la rasha v'oy l'shcheno. Well, over here it's 2 reshaim, not 1. So this Gaddafi, he once said to the Arabs, I don't understand why we're fighting. I don't understand why we're fighting. All we have to do is to give birth to people, to kids. And we will win the whole world. Just give birth. Don't need terrorism and all that. Continue to give birth. You occupy the whole world. The world is stupid. They have democracy, no? Every country will become the majority, including Israel. Clever, no? That's what's happening. I was just in Europe. The airport, full of Arabs. You're not sure if you're in Europe or you're in an Arab country. You're not sure. Mamash, unbelievable.
Very scary.
You know how many soldiers, how many dogs. It's very intimidating, the airports. And Belgium, in March, they had a huge attack there. You cannot drop passenger in the airport anymore. You cannot pick up anyone, and you cannot drop anyone. You don't have access to the terminal with a car. You have to go to the parking. Up to 15 minutes, they made it free. You want to pick up someone, you have to park the car and walk without the car. I came very early in the morning. I landed Friday morning there. Now I was looking for the guy that picks me up, but he wasn't there yet. And I didn't know about all the changes in the arrangement because I've been there many times. So I went outside. I said, I'm going to go outside. Maybe he's standing with the car outside. I walked one step out, looked like this. He's not there. I turn around to Kamir, the soldier. You're not going in. So why? You went out, you cannot come back in. So, but you saw me going out. You're standing here, I was... cannot go back. You want to go back, leave all your suitcases outside and I search on you. They search people who walks in. You cannot go in with bags. They're waking up, the Europeans. It's too late. They lost the war already. There's nothing they can do. It will get to a point that the Arabs will not only be a majority, they will be an active majority, meaning the Goyim will run away from Europe. They're already running to Canada now, to America, to everywhere they can run. They'll be scared to live there. Scary, very scary. So this is it. The Arabs don't need to do anything. All they have to do is just give birth. ISIS and all of that, it only makes the situation a lot worse. But even without all of that, the fact that they would become the majority in every country and they will get elected to be the president because they are the majority and that's democracy. And right away, they make a Sharia law. We are the majority here. We're changing all the laws. What can you do? And it happens very fast. They say by 2020, the majority of Europe will be Arabs. By 2020, I think they exaggerate, maybe it will be 230, 240, doesn't matter, it's in our time. Democracy became right now the biggest danger to civilization. The biggest danger, why? I give you an example. Now in Israel, you have democracy. they want to change the law that the mosque, they scream at 4 a.m. every morning and they blast the whole neighborhoods over there. People are sleeping with their mosque, with the voices, unbelievable. Some people live close to the mosque, blow up the house, the windows, everything. It's so loud because they want the whole town to hear it. I don't have to tell you. So now they cannot change the law in Israel, because the religious people in few neighborhoods, in Bnei Brak, Yerushalayim, they have a little siren half an hour before Shabbat. Once a week, they make a little siren that for Jews will know that Shabbat is coming soon. It's only one time a week, and it's only mamash very short, 20, 30 seconds, and that's it. And it's in a neighborhood that everyone religious. It's not everywhere, all over Israel. It's only in Jerusalem and Bnei Brak, when 99.5% of the people are full, very religious. So everyone is interested in a siren. And the siren is not at 4 a.m. to wake up anyone. It's in the evening, in a early evening. So the Arabs that sits in the government, all the terrorists, they say, we will go to Bagatz. You know what Bagatz mean? The Israeli liberal lefty judges, who are the cancer of our nation, those judges. They're worse than Nazis, worse. Every decision they made is against the Torah, everything. Every decision is against yeshivot, against religious people, against everything. Always pro-Arab, always give the terrorists what they want. That's those judges, those liberal, self-hated Jews. So they say, the Arabs know that they are their partners. They're helping them to take over Israel. So right away they say, no problem, change the law. We go to the Bagatz, they cancel it anyway, like all the other laws you change. Every time they change a law, the Arabs take advantage on those liberal Jews. They know they are their partners. They call him judge, no problem, Ahmed. No problem, in the name of peace. Sure, peace. Ahmed say, I'm lucky the Jews are so dumb. The next day they cancel the government's decision. So really in Israel you don't have a government, it's all a show. Those liberal lefty Jew haters judges are the one who control Israel for 60 years already. They make all the decision. Every decision your government makes they don't like, they cancel. The government decided to make a wall around Israel. They stopped it in many places. Why? They want the terrorists to have access to come in. They don't want it to be complete. So they did 80% only. But they left gates that they can come in. And many of pieces of the wall, they say you have to bring it down. Why? Because it was on Palestinian property. That's what they said. But the Arabs in East Jerusalem, they build hundreds of homes on Jewish properties. Jewish properties with papers. Now, once they say to knock down one Arab property, always Jewish property, always. Jewish liberals, never once. The mayor of Jerusalem announced a few days ago that the city hall of Jerusalem have hundreds of properties that Arabs built on Jewish property and stole the property. From 70 years ago, 8 years ago, belongs to Jews. They just build over there. That's it, and there's nothing you can do. They used to be very violent with rifles and guns. They had the power back then. They stole the property. The Jews have proofs. So the mayor of Jerusalem say, if you evict the Jews from the neighborhood Amona, where they live right now, you want to bring down the whole town, like you did with Gush Katif and you gave it to the Hamas, we will go and knock down all the Arab houses that were built on Jewish property, and we have hundreds of addresses. Do you think they're going to be able to? I promise you, they won't let them. They are the enemies. The Arabs are only doing what the Bagatz tell them to do. Mamash Erev Rav that sits among us and destroy us from day one. Those are the judges. That's it. They are pro-gays. They are the ones gay marriage. They hate religion. So Ahmed Tibi, Yimach Shimo, the terrorist that hugged Arafat in every possible opportunity, he said, I'm going to go to Bagatz, to the Supreme Court. So right away, they had to change the law. That now everyone will continue to suffer from the scream of this mosque every morning, 4 a.m. Why? Because the Israeli judges, freedom of religion. Ah, yeah? Freedom of religion? The chief rabbi of the army was elected by the chief commander of the Israeli army. He's a secular Jew. He has to nominate a rabbi to the army, chief rabbi of the army. He nominated an Arab in the army. They did to him what they do to me all the time. They checked in his lectures and they found controversial remarks against women. What was the controversial remarks? He was explaining what the Torah says when a man goes to the war and he sees a beautiful Goya and he falls in love with her. You know, Eshet Yifat Tohar. This was 3,000 years ago. So he used to take the Goya, make her shave her head, and she dressed like a prisoner. She has to make long nails, and he takes her home. She's a prisoner of war. And he can be with her, and they saw that. Racist, he's against women, he's against Goyim. They destroyed him on the media. You have to see what these fools, how dumb they are. They don't even understand what was back then, what's today. They made him like he's a Saddam Hussein or something. And that he spoke against gays. That he spoke that gay is a despicable act. It's against Hashem and the Torah. So we don't want a chief rabbi that is against gays and women. So the Bagat, the Supreme Court in Israel, canceled his nomination this morning. They want a reform rabbi that he himself is a gay. That will perform gay ceremonies in the army. That's what they want. And they call it democracy. Manian, democracy always to the side of the wicked people. Whenever it's religion or something that God wants, right away they run to destroy it in the name of democracy. You cannot speak. They block them out. The chief rabbi of Jerusalem, which was the chief rabbi of Israel, Rabbi Amar, the most gentle speaker you will ever hear. Now, one time in his lecture, he spoke something hard, like Gehenom or punishment or Mechalel Shabbat is a goy. None of this. He just spoke about the gay parade. That it's Toava. Toava means despicable. That's it, one word. One week they butcher him on the media nonstop. You have to resign, you have to resign. They want to block the mouth of the rabbis that they won't be able to say anything that they don't like. The lefty, liberal, self-hated Jews who destroyed not only the Jewish nation, destroyed the whole world. And then when they bring another Holocaust on the Jewish nation, who are they going to blame? The religious people. They're going to find who to blame. Even here in America. In America, you know how many people hate Jews because of those kind of Jews? You know, sometimes people send me parts from the radio that the host, a Jew, called the show. And the goy, the host, is asking him, what's wrong with the Jews? How can they vote Hillary? How can they vote for this and for that and for that? Aren't the Jews supposed to be normal people, smart people? Why would they help the Arab to destroy them? Why wouldn't automatically vote for Trump? It's the best thing that can happen to them. This goy was asking all these questions. He doesn't understand. The goy doesn't understand how the Jews can be so dumb. You know, these lectures that I made 2 weeks ago about Trump, you know that now it's 13 days. Tomorrow will be 2 weeks. It became a sensation, 170,000 views in 13 days. They're calling me from all the radio stations, from here, from Vegas, all kinds of places, to interview me on the radio. Yeah, 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 because they, you know how it is. People send it to the radio. But you know what? One very interesting thing. Today someone sent today a message. Did you know that they have Muslim camps all over the United States? Yeah. 30,000 jihad soldiers with weapon permitted. In New York they have a camp. 3,000 soldiers upstate New York.
Are you serious? I thought it was a joke.
No, it's not a joke. I actually saw them with the pictures with their guns. And the FBI knows about it.
Yes.
The authority knows about it, and the attorney general say it's according to the law. There's nothing we can do until they're gonna come and do an act of terrorism. There's nothing we can do. They can preach whatever they want, and they preach to to destroy America. They preach all of that, but there's nothing they do. So one person say today, send this video to Trump. The battery. Just replay. Yeah, no, it's about to finish. No. I just see if it's... I have to say goodbye before it's finished. So say, send it to Trump. So the guy say, of course, first thing I did is send it to Trump. Maybe he's going to start closing those camps.
Yeah,
Hillary would send them budgets. Dear Ahmed, I got a lot of money from Qatar and Dubai. I have to show you some gratitude. Your weapon is old. Maybe you want some tanks, courtesy of Uncle Sam. You understand what's happening here? That's what's going on. The liberalism, hating God, hating rabbis, hating Torah, brings instead Ahmed, Hamas, Hezbollah, Jihad, Al-Qaeda, ISIS. That's what you get instead. The European killed the Jews. The European took the Jewish property. They kicked the Jews out. Hashem gave them a nice gift instead. Arabs took over Europe. Everywhere that they kick the Jews, the Arabs will take over. This is how it goes. In America, if she would eventually get elected, it would be the end of us. Just a matter of time.
Absolutely.
She would continue the Obama and become even worse. Now we at least have a hope. Will he be able to make the change? We will be smart in 4 years to know. Hopefully, yes. It looks like the character, he is going to make some changes. The problem here is not alone. You have Congress, you have a lot of Democrats around. In New York, for instance, the mayor of New York already announced that if he will go after Muslims in New York, in any possible way, the city of New York will fight him and will not obey the federal laws. Already, he's already announced yesterday that they're going to rebel against the federal government. No, de Blasio, another liberal, what? And they will not help to evict any Hispanic or Spanish illegal person in New York. They have nothing to worry about. They won't obey the rules.
Schumer is probably also with him on that.
He's going to hold back federal money for them.
We will see about it.
Why doesn't Netanyahu do anything?
Netanyahu, until now, was a puppet of Obama. Now maybe he will come out of the box. Maybe he will have freedom to talk. Until now, 8 years. Obama was controlling it with remote control. Bibi gun, you know Bibi gun? Bibi, I saw you build another wall next to Jerusalem over there. Take it down immediately. Okay, Barack, I'm so sorry, I didn't know about it. Maybe now things are going to change. We'll see you next Tuesday. Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen v'amen.